And in order to adapt your pitches, actually, you must keep in mind that there are basically four or five different sorts of acquisition. So you have the sort of what we often call the corporate development. In most cases, you know, corporate development means M&A of a business that is being acquired because it's a matter of revenue, EBITDA, you apply EBITDA multiple, you integrate that company, and you've got immediate, you know, cash flow. And so it's about revenue, it's about customer acquisition. In most cases, there are acquisitions made by companies where the M&A process is led by the CFO himself. So that's one category. The second category is the reason of the acquisition is because of your IP, your technology, the particular ability that once integrated, your technology could contribute to better governance, to better features, a more protectable IP product. So that's the matter here is about how can they integrate your technology. So it's about the technology architecture itself, and IP, and patents. It's also a matter of the team. How can the team integrate with the R&D team, or product team? The next reason is product. What I call product is a new product, or a particular feature of an existing product, or a particular performance of an existing product branch. And so you're going to integrate the business unit with a product manager who wants that product to broaden this product branch. The fourth category of acquisition is the buyer wants you because of a new business model. For instance, if you used to be on an hardware business model, selling boxes, you want to migrate into a software business model, software defined something. So it doesn't really pay attention to the classical revenue, EBITDA sort of things. Of course, it is part of that. But it's mostly willing to get a team and its ability to sell something as a service and, of course, have enough market traction to justify that acquisition. That's more and more the case. Gartner made a report a few years ago called Techquisition. Techquisition is a trend of non-technology businesses that want to embrace digital economy, and therefore they must make some acquisition of digital businesses like online services or software as a service sort of things. So that's the business model is the main reason. And then the last reason is a mix of different components. So for instance, when Apple buy Shazam, 400 million, 80 years after the foundation of Shazam, it is for its technology, it is for its 37 million of revenues, but it is also for its 250 people, part of the team, that we can integrate and make not only a new service, but also a team that can do more. So it's a mix of everything. And as you know, in the technology world, we are at the war of talents on a global basis. So cybersecurity, for instance, is mostly being driven in terms of money, mostly being driven by the quality of talent you can acquire, even if a business, the top line is relatively modest. And the last thing I would comment is, once you have the right level of engagement with a potential buyer, then comes the due diligence process. You know, due diligence is after you made the decision to buy that company, you have based your decision on a certain number of parameters. You've got approval to pay that price. Now you want to check that your assumptions were right. So you have many different people checking everything. And Chris Gilbert, who talked later, CEO, founder of Uniquisis, is one of the best practices I've seen in that category of things. First he's been talking to Cisco for years to develop a business partnership. And the guy from the EU at Cisco were just in love with the company and how helpful Uniquisis was to open your conversation with large customers. Number two, when we have decided to engage with a Unicosys for commercial acquisition, I went to Chris's office in Freedom, UK. It was, I think, on the Thursday morning, and we have agreed that next Monday, Chris will be in San Francisco, in our office, with his main team, 5-10 guys, and on my side, I have brought 30 people from San Francisco. So that was on a Thursday morning. On a Monday morning, Chris had managed to organize all of that, and we met in San Francisco on Monday morning. We spent 3-4 days of intense preliminary due diligence, checking everything, talking about everything, strategy, execution, engineering, all of that. And a few days later, we came back with a term sheet. And without a good reactivity from the target company, we would not have been able to do it. And I guess Chris is going to tell you and share more later about his experience selling his company to CISO. But I think Cisco is the best practice in terms of acquisition, but especially Unicosys is also a very good best practice in terms of selling your company. Something I've noticed as well with Chris Liebert is that I've been talking with different people with Cisco at least a few years before being handed to a company. And every time, and I was, networking in the oil industry, and from time to time, I was asking, Unicosys, what do you think? And every time I found a guy who used to be in the former team of Chris Liebert. And so the ability that Chris had to have a global network of folks who like him, who's been working with him in his previous companies, Motorola, for instance, it was sort of amazing, because wherever you were looking at, you found a guy, what do you think about Unicosys? What a great company, great CEO, great team. That's very important, you see, to build a momentum within a 70,000 people organization. And the last thing I've exemplified by this acquisition is the fact that the valuation is mostly driven by a couple of things. So, how unique is your business, technology, IP-wise, customer-wise? It's all about differentiation. And it's all about building up a business plan. And of course, the better, the larger the business you can build, the more keen you are to pay the high price. In that particular case, Unicosys team did a fantastic job at influencing the CISO's business unit in terms of establishing the business drivers, how large is going to be the market, what's going to be the price point, these sort of things. And that has led to a very significant exit valuation, because this company could have been acquired for 20 times less. It has not been the case because they made a specific job to influence the business plan built up on top of that acquisition. So in summary, I would say the exit process is not a goal per se, but certainly something you must think relatively in advance and as early in your cycle as possible. And make sure that your exit way is consistent with your business focus. So as a CEO, you must be business focused, of course. But it doesn't prevent to capture the sign of the market from an M&A perspective. Because it's not something completely different. It's very consistent. If you are developing a new service with a new business model for a new target market, there must be someone at some point who's going to like it. And this is also a good indication of where the market is going.
Thank you. Wonderful. So, we have some
some time for questions. So I'm just going to bring a couple of seats. So you can take a bit of a break.
So I think you raised a really difficult to text again. So you probably get a sense of how much more could be said about. Just thinking about like all the things you said, there's just so many points you could go dive deeper into around like which companies have done well, which have been problematic, what kind of like red flags you see on the way. Maybe to just get started, do we have some questions already? Yes. Okay. So I'll just start on that one. Let's see yourself.
One of the challenges for people today is when talking with corporates and large organizations is the balance between are they just digging for ideas from us, or are they...
So when you talk to corporates, it's not always clear whether they're just trying to get your ideas, learn from you, or wasting your time, or they're actually serious about doing business or something else.
How would you tend to approach that? Because we tend to be quite cautious, but...
How much do you disclose, I guess?
Okay, very good question, I think. So I've been doing corporate, so I've been doing VC for 6 years, and I now I'm back in VC, and in the meantime I've done 12 years of corporate VC. Is corporate VC a way to spy? Yes, let's be honest. Not spy in the sense of anything illegal, of course, but spy in the sense of creating market insight. But the beauty of that is that it can be mutually beneficial, because the more I can learn from you, if I'm sitting on Cisco side, 70,000 people, if I'm an executive, so many people are telling me about what I should do, what I should focus on. And I have a very good view of the existing markets and the existing customers. I'm missing completely what's happening on the emerging trends. And an opportunity to talk with the CEO of the startup is a fantastic opportunity for any executive to learn what's going on at a very early stage of the nascent market. And so I don't think you should be afraid to share any insight of what you do, because it's a way for the corporate to learn from something. And through that process, you can influence the corporate to pay better attention to what you're doing. And I don't think you should be afraid that they're going to pick your idea and try to do it today. Because first, they are not capable. Second, why would they do that? It's so uncertain. How large is going to be your market in 2 years' time? If it's not a billion, I don't care. How good your technology architecture is going to be in 2 years' time when the market happen to be a billion in potential, maybe it's not going to be the right architecture anymore. So there are plenty of reasons that I'm not sure I want to buy that company or do what you do at that stage, but it may be something I would like to learn, I would like to stay closer, and if we make a partnership, we can experiment something together. It's a co-development process. It's not about stealing your IP or something like that. Yes, it could happen. Some bad guys may be willing to do it, but it's going to damage their reputation badly. And in most cases, they are very concerned of not doing it. And companies like Cisco, for instance, they always think if it's good technology, good team, good business, we're willing to pay the right price. Not the problem. What we want is growth. It's not about paying cheap. Other guys may be willing to pay cheap and do bad things to maximize it, but it's not the majority. And you can deal with that for legal terms of your partnership agreements, confidentiality, non-competitivity, sort of clause.
Okay, I've heard of some startups who, on the opposite, kind of play hard to get and try to be very secretive and basically turn down most of meeting requests to come. Also raise interest? Does that sound like a sensible strategy?
The startup or
the startup turning down meetings.
Well, I don't think so. I don't think so. I mean, I'm not necessarily writing everything. Just I am like I am. This has never been my strategy, you know, refusing to. I like to talk to everyone, even if I have not a lot of time. Oh, I know other guys are like this. They want to create a rarity, you know, to make more attractive the opportunity to establish here. It's up to everyone. But personally, I haven't done that either.
You're both thinking from the startup side, trying to be this, the founder, turning down meetings, trying to stay out of the, like, not to talk too much corporate.
Yeah, I really don't see the benefit of doing that. I mean, if they believe it is not worth a discussion, they can have a quick discussion and explain why. Even if the guy is not senior enough, he can send someone from his team. There's no good reason for not to need to talk. I mean, you know, when you see as an investor, when you see entrepreneur and say, well, we don't want to discuss without any NDA, it's never a good sign. It probably means a lack of IP. Defensible IP and means a lack of confidence that we can build a win-win partnership.
Okay, we got some more questions. Yes.
About expertise experience, because you are in Cisco, such an American big company, I'd like to have your view in the comparison US with Europe. Is it like startups are selling too soon and you don't have these champions like the US? Like, how the M&A in that market is different from Europe, and how does that?
Yeah, for sure. So that's a recurring matter. I mean, it's not so great. US companies are more acquisitive than European. However, US companies started to invest in Europe a few years ago, more massively. For instance, when I joined Cisco, we had almost no acquisition or investment done for the last 10 years before my time. And during my time, we've grown from 0 to 48% of acquisition made in Europe. Because we have plenty of software infrastructure company available with growth profile.
Cheaper in Europe?
And so, absolutely, I mean, cheaper, so the entry valuation are cheaper, the exit valuation are cheaper, but the burn rate are also cheaper. And all in all, when you look at, so there's a statistic I looked at a few years ago. When you look at all the exits above $100 million, actually the financial returns are better in Europe than they are in the US.
Because in the US, from the VC perspective?
Yeah. Because in the US, they have to pay an higher price, an higher burn rate. They have an higher exit as well, but altogether.
They raise more rounds. Yeah. That's it. So the question is also...
And also the last thing is that with the digital economy, the digital transformation, you're going to see more and more European companies who are going to change their mindset. They used to be, we grow by ourselves, we do R&D, and we only acquire very, very rarely. Now, because we have a digital transformation strategy, we must embrace acquisition as well. Typical example is Engie, acquiring Ceradel because it's a 3D modeling software for digital city.
Just a quick follow-up on that is that do you think European companies sell cheaper because they don't know how to negotiate better? Or is it because their technology is not as attractive? Or what's the reason?
Well, I think, you know, the valuation of a company is not an exact science. You have about 15 different models to assess the valuation of the company, discounted cash flow, EBITDA multiple and others. But at the end of the day, people tend to forget that it's just a matter of demand and offer. That's the only thing. So if you can't manage to have enough demand, of course you won't be in a good position to sell at a better price. So this is where an investment banker can possibly help is organizing this market.
Just another quick follow-on, I see we have more questions. Another thing around corporates is that, so Cisco has a lot of experience. You have an integration team in addition to the corporate development team. You even have a founders forum inside the company that basically networks all the founders of the companies you acquired. Corporates also go through a learning curve in terms of corporate development acquisitions, and many of them are big beginners. They do their first deals. Sometimes they buy something really expensive that we don't have to deal with. So that, how do you recognize when you meet a corporate the level of experience they have? How can you evaluate that through the conversation? Does that make a difference for a founder?
Well, I think it's more a question for Chris Gilbert here, but I think any potential buyer is different culture, different size, different mindset, different people to interact with. If it's a large corporate, you don't have to deal with corporate development, with the business unit, the engineering, the functional team, the legal team, the tax team, everything. So it's not a unique personality, it's a multiple, it's like a multiple head, you know, person.
Okay. I have one more question here, and then I'll take yours. Yes.
Yeah, that's it. Sorry. From all your experience doing acquisition and buying, is there one simple frustration that comes up from a personal point of view when you go through the process? Putting aside, obviously, we've discussed already, and also preparations from the target company side. Is that a red flag that you always go, that's a real bad issue for me?
Yes, I would say, good question. I would say, you know, as a European guy working for US companies for 20 years, the more likely to be that sort of frustration is you've been working very hard to promote European company as a potential acquisition target. They've got good IP, good team, good market traction, the right business model, everything, right? And you are successful at engaging with a certain business unit, you know, to do this. And then suddenly, you know, business unit decide that this company in the Silicon Valley just makes more sense for them. They are smaller. The technology is very difficult to know exactly which one is the best, but they are local and they have the same culture and they speak the same English. And the deal is going into the Silicon Valley, and this is all you can do.
Okay, good.
You mentioned that growth is a key driver for corporate development, so it's one of the potential acquisitions. How do corporate development teams see the deal for more impact operations? So, Amazon buying key warehouse robotics companies actually impact their bottom line rather than help drive revenue?
Oh, yeah, so the question is around. There's acquisitions focused on growth, but some can deal operations like Kiva acquiring Amazon acquiring the Kiva, the robots in the warehouse to make them more efficient. That's something also.
Yeah, I think that's back to the five. You must understand the reason the corporate is willing to proceed to acquire. Is it for revenue, customer base, growth, or is it for a particular product? Or particular technology IP, or the chip, or a mix of all that, you must understand.